and welcome to our service from Holy Trinity in Tulse Hill, where we find God's love that flows through our building, our people, our community, and we hope that you'd find God's presence wherever you are this morning or this afternoon or whenever you listen to this sermon online. Richard will deliver our sermon to us this morning, and it will be taken from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 to 18, with the theme, The Greatest Sacrifice. But before we have our reading and we get into our worship, let us have a moment of quietness as we allow God to bring His Spirit into our hearts. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for this morning. We bring ourselves before you that you bless us and uplift our spirit to hear your word. Let us be part of this worship this morning and allow your word to be delivered that we may be transformed into the likeness and image of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
This passage is taken from Hebrews 10, verses 1 to 18. The Jewish law is not a full and faithful model of the real things. It is only a faint outline of the good things to come. The same sacrifices are offered forever, year after year. How can the law then, by means of these sacrifices, make perfect the people who come to God? If the people worshipping God had really been purified from their sins, they would not feel guilty of sin anymore, and all sacrifices would stop. As it is, however, the sacrifices serve year after year to remind people of their sins. For the blood of bulls and goats can never take away sins. For this reason, when Christ was about to come into the world, he said to God, "You do not want sacrifices and offerings, but you have prepared a body for me. You are not pleased with animals burnt on the altar, or with sacrifices to take away sins." Then I said, "Here I am to do your will, O God, just as it is written of me in the book of law." First he said, "You neither want nor are pleased with sacrifices and offerings, or with animals burned on the altar and the sacrifices to take away sins." He said this even though all the sacrifices are offered according to the law. Then he said, "Here I am, O God, to do your will." So God does away with all the old sacrifices and puts the sacrifice of Christ in their place. Because Jesus Christ did what God wanted him to, we are all purified from sin by the offering that he made of his own body once and for all. Every Jewish priest performs his services every day and serves the same sacrifice many times, but these sacrifices can never take away sins. Christ, however, offered one sacrifice for sins, an offering that is effective forever. And then he sat down at the right side of God. There he now waits until God puts his enemies as a footstool under his feet. With one sacrifice, then, he has made perfect forever those who are purified from sin. And the Holy Spirit also gives us his witness. First, he says, "This is the covenant that I will make with them in the days to come, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and write them on their minds." And then he says, "I will not remember their sins and evil deeds any longer. So when these have been forgiven, an offering to take away sins is no longer needed." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, recently I started reading a book called The Bible in Politics by Richard Balcombe. Richard Balcombe is one of my favourite theological writers because of his unrelenting creativity and his absolute commitment to relevance. In the introduction to his book, he talks about the Old Testament, and he says that the Old Testament doesn't provide us with instructions for political or legal life because it was actually written for a very different time and context. Nevertheless, it is utterly instructive. In other words, by the Holy Spirit, God speaks to us through the scriptures, including the Old Testament, and helps us to find our own way for our own time. This distinction between giving instructions and being instructive, I found extremely helpful as I was thinking through some of the ethical issues of our day. Well, the writer of Hebrews certainly finds his scriptures instructive, but he also realizes that some of the instructions contained within them are no longer relevant. So today I want to take a little detour in our study of Hebrews to learn from how this writer actually does his theology, how this writer actually works things out for his Christian life and for the church. Because as we observe this process in him, as we see the cogs whirring around in his brain, we can also ourselves be equipped to work things out in our own lives, in our own church, in our own world. So my three headings today are, firstly, that in doing his theology, our writer is critical. Secondly, he is Christ-centered. And thirdly, he is conclusive. Well, I wonder if you've ever been scolded for being too critical. Sometimes we feel bad for being critical. The word has a bad press. I wouldn't mind writing reviews for films, but the idea of being called a film critic seems a bit distasteful, doesn't it? It sounds like I'm wired up to be negative or mean-spirited. This is where it's helpful to recall that our group of words, critic, critical, criticise, criticism, that sort of word, they all come from the Greek word krino, which means to show judgment, to evaluate. It can mean to select or approve. And these aren't negative things in the slightest bit. In fact, we exercise judgment every day. What should I wear? What shall we eat for dinner? Is it going to rain? Will I need an umbrella? Should I buy this one or that one? Should I trust this person's word or should I be cautious? All these things are judgments. In each case, we're exercising our critical faculties. But when it comes to the Bible or things of the church, teachings and traditions, we often shrink back. We're afraid of being critical. Sometimes we think, it's not my place. But the writer of Hebrews clearly thought it was his place, and it is our place. We need to challenge. We need to ask questions. We need to evaluate. Some scholars link our writer with the Hellenist Christians, of whom Stephen was perhaps the most famous. You'll remember that Stephen was stoned to death by the Pharisees in Acts chapter 7 for his radical teachings about the temple, for saying that the temple was now redundant, that it wasn't needed, this glorious place, that it had become obsolete. And they were called Hellenists because they were imbued with their kind of modernist Greek influenced teaching that was typical more of Jews that came from all around the Mediterranean, as opposed to the more conservative Judean Jews in the Jewish heartland. Our writer of Hebrews seems to have a similar outlook to Stephen and those others like him. He's asking questions of the traditions. He's asking questions even of the scriptures, the Old Testament law. He's evaluating the most cherished ways in which things were done. He's turning over the most venerated institutions. He's looking at scriptures not so much for instructions to obey, but he's looking to the scriptures to see how they can be instructive, to learn from them, to give understanding to us. In short, he has a critical approach, an evaluative approach. Let's look at verses 1 to 4, where we can see this approach in action. Verse 1 is a confident and direct evaluation of perhaps the most prized aspect of the Jewish faith. Listen to what he says. The Jewish law is not a full and faithful model of the real things. It is only a faint outline of the good things to come. This is a shocking thing to say, not least in the context where many will have grown up to be faithful, law-loving Jews. Remember Psalm 19? The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. This is the high esteem with which the law of God in Scripture was regarded, and yet our writer calls it a faint outline. Next, he complains, he almost ridicules the accepted status quo. Listen to this. The same sacrifices are offered forever, year after year. How can the law, by means of these sacrifices, make perfect the people who come to God? You see, he's daring to ask questions of Scripture. He goes on in verse 2. If the people worshipping God really had been purified from their sins, they would not feel guilty of sin anymore. Then in verse 4, the blood of bulls can never take away sins. If you've been a Christian for some years, you'll probably take all of these things for granted. But imagine the impact of his critical thinking in the first century. Imagine the impact on his listeners. This preacher was the kind of radical your parents warned you against. A friend of mine used to say, I try not to sit in judgment over Scripture, but rather I try to let Scripture sit in judgment over me. And I used to think this was a really, really helpful motto. It is, but there's ways in which I'm not too sure now. The Bible shows us that to do theology, we need to ask questions of Scripture. We need to engage our critical faculties. We need to evaluate and form judgments. So we don't work out our Christian lives simply by looking at the Bible and asking, what are the God's instructions for today? But rather by looking at the Bible and asking, how is this instructive for me? What is this teaching me? What's the direction of travel as we follow through the two testaments? There's a great Sunday school saying that you may have heard, description of the Bible, basic instructions before leaving earth. Yes, I love that. I've always remembered it. I think it's very clever. It's neat. It's humorous. But is it true? Well, it may be true for Sunday school, but it won't really do for us as adults. We need to be more critical. However, in part two, we'll also see that the writer is Christ-centered.
Give us understanding. Of everything you're speaking. Give us understanding. To know the only true God. Merciful High Priest, open our eyes, overwhelm our souls with eternal light. Merciful High Priest, open our eyes, overwhelm our soul with eternal light. cost my feet to walk in your high places, Most High. Cost my heart to know in the secret place of the Most High. Cost my ears to hear the secret things, many things of the Most Holy. Cost my soul to know the secret things of the Most Holy True God. Oh, I want to know as you know. I want to see as you see. I want to hear as you hear in the Most High. Oh, I want to know as you know. I want to see as you see. I want to hear as you hear the only true God. Merciful High Priest, open our eyes, overwhelm our souls with eternal life. Merciful High Priest, open our eyes, overwhelm our souls with eternal light. O Kojaimo, O Kojaoye, this eternal life that the High Priest is talking about. It is the high places, the most holy place, the holy of holies, wherein the foreigner has entered. O Kojaimo, O Kojaoye, it is the DNA of the Son of God. It is the high places, the most holy place, the holy of holies, wherein the foreigner has entered. Would you give us understanding? Of everything you're saying, you're speaking, saying. Oh, give us understanding. To know the only true God.
Well, last week I said that the present time in which we live is divided up into the old normal and the new normal, and that the thing that makes the difference between the old normal and the new normal is the coming of Jesus Christ and the difference that he makes. Well, this division is typical of how our writer to the Hebrews thinks and how he does his theology, because all his thinking is Christ-centered. Although this letter has a reputation for being all about obscure Old Testament characters and Jewish religious ritual, it's actually all about Jesus. That's why I call it the parable of the Son. It's all about the Son of God and what happened to him on the surface of history when he came into our world and what he was really achieving behind the scenes. On the surface, he may have looked like little more than another failed Messiah, but behind the scenes, he was God's Son achieving purification for the sins of the world. So look at verse 5. The writer's just about to quote from Psalm 40, but whenever he reads the scriptures, he's trying to see how they relate to Jesus Christ. So in this case, he puts the words of Psalm 40 into the mouth of Christ. Listen, for this reason, when Christ was about to come into the world, he said to God, You did not want sacrifices and offerings. Then he said, here I am to do your will. It may seem strange for us to read this today. After all, how did the writer know that Christ said these words to the Father? These are the words of David, the psalmist. But for our writer, of course, they're also words of Scripture. Scripture is the word of God. Jesus the Son is himself God. So Jesus could have spoken, has spoken, if you like, these words. Of course, that doesn't mean that every word of Scripture should be applied to Jesus or put in his mouth, because as we've already seen, you have to use your critical faculties. But with that gift of evaluation fully in gear, knowing all that you know about Jesus, you then read the Scriptures and begin to notice the direction of travel through them. In other words, the ways in which they point to Christ. Do you like seeing how things are put together? When I was a boy, my weekly comic, Look and Learn, often had immensely detailed cutaway drawings of things like jumbo jets or oil tankers or aircraft carriers, things like that. I love to see how things are put together. I love to see people's working out, how they get to where they get to. Well, in verses 8 to 10, our writer also shows his working out as to how Psalm 40 points to Jesus. He says, first, Christ said, you neither want nor are you pleased with the sacrifices on the altar. And our writer struck by this, because as he goes on to say, he said this even though these sacrifices are offered according to the law. In other words, he's saying, look, you can see this written in Scripture in the Psalms. Jesus is saying it. He seems to be contradicting what was also written in the Scriptures, in the law. So our writer's brought short by this apparent contradiction. It makes him think, could this be something to do with the new normal that has broken in, brought in by Jesus? Then he reads on in Psalm 40. Here I am to do your will, O God. And because he's already thinking about Jesus and the new normal and Jesus coming into the world, he can suddenly imagine with his spirit Jesus saying these words to the Father as he stands, if you like, on the point of entering our world. It all suddenly makes sense. The Scripture has secretly revealed how Jesus' self-sacrifice brought complete atonement where all those other sacrifices fall far short. And so he concludes, because Jesus Christ did what God wanted him to do, we are all purified from sin by the offering that he has made in his own body once and for all. Well, that's a little bit about how the writer does his theology. He not only engages his critical faculties, but he applies them to thinking about Jesus and how Jesus has brought about the new normal. In part three, we'll see that he is also conclusive.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, we thank you for everything you've done in our lives. We stand in awe of the continued favor and mercy we enjoy from you each passing day. May we always be reminded that you are the God of history, not of one nation, not of one people, but the God of the universe. Have mercy on us, Father, and forgive us all for our folly. Kindle in us the desire to make you the center of our lives. Instill in us the spirit of love, understanding, forgiveness, and tolerance with a new attitude towards you, your word, and with each other. Father, strengthen us to stand firm, particularly in these trying times where we can be easily led, pushed beyond limits, or drawn away from you and your word. when doubt sets in and nothing makes sense to us, look into our hearts, search our minds, and equip us with your word to see the way forward and learn to do what is right and pleasing to you. This morning, I bring before you the sick and those on the verge of dying, that they might find healing and peace. I also commit into your hands all those known or unknown to our church family who have recently died. Father, console and mend their broken hearts. And may the memories of the years gone by bring them joy. And at their weakest, protect and toughen them in each trying day through the power of your Spirit. We also pray for church leaders throughout the world as they continue to spread the good news. We also ask for protection for people held in captivity or those threatened in war-torn areas we see and read about in the media. May Christ give them all peace, protection, and hope for the future. Mighty Father, be ever present in our lives as we learn to make you the center of our lives. The honor, glory, power, and praise be yours forever and ever. Amen.
Remember the Lord Jesus, who on the night he was betrayed, took bread and gave thanks to God. He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is God's new covenant sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink, do so in remembrance of me." And that is how much God loves you.
Well, we've already seen in part two how the writer moves towards a conclusion. One of his great qualities is that he never sits on the fence. In verses 11 to 12, he sums up one of the core messages of his book. This is what he says. Every Jewish priest performs his service every day, but these sacrifices can never take away sins. Christ, however, offered one sacrifice for sins, an offering that is effective forever. The rest of the passage to verse 18 reiterates this conclusion again and again. You see, there's a time for saying, "I'm not sure, I'm thinking about it," but there's a time for making a decision, a time for conclusion, maybe a time for resolution. Here, our writer's bold enough to state his opinion, his conclusion. And in fact, of course, the church later on even came to recognize this radical, bold opinion is the Word of God in New Testament Scripture. How do we reach that point of conclusion as Christians? Well, first, by doing our thinking and our questioning, even questioning the sacred teachings and traditions of our faith and scriptures. Second, by reflecting on Jesus and how he connects with the matter. But then we need to draw to a conclusion. We need to dare to be wrong because we might actually get it right. Of course, in that process, there's all sorts of other bits of learning and reading that we do, reading and talking with other Christians, praying, etc., etc. But at some point, we have to draw our own conclusion and we have to dare to be wrong because we might well be right. You know what? I'm glad that we're all amateurs when it comes to being human. A professional person can only act to the level of their competence, and they have insurance to cover them according to their qualifications and the professional trust that people put in them. When they reach the level of their competence, if they can't answer the question, they have to refer it to someone else. They can't draw a conclusion based only on their opinion. They have to refer on if they have reached the level of their competence. They have to refer to another expert so that they don't become liable for getting it wrong. And that's how, of course, everyone makes money. The architect refers to the engineer refers to the inspector, and so on and so on. No professional can afford to get it wrong. It would undermine their whole being as a professional. But when it comes to being human, we're all amateurs. When it comes to our relationship with God, we're all amateurs. So you can have an opinion. You can draw a conclusion. It might be wrong. So what? We're amateurs. It's provisional anyway. It's there to help you along the road. Your voice is valid. And when we get things wrong, that's fine. It's just another stepping stone towards getting it right. So don't be afraid. Back in the 1990s, a youth group leader in Michigan began a movement to help teenagers follow Jesus more closely. The idea was to wear a bracelet with the letters WWJD written on it. What would Jesus do? Maybe you have one of those bracelets somewhere. In fact, the phrase, what would Jesus do, had been coined over 100 years earlier as the subtitle of one of the best-selling novels ever by Charles Sheldon, In His Steps. Now, the wearing of bracelets may or may not be your style, but I love that simple question, what would Jesus do? It doesn't tell you the answer. It assumes that the answer may not even be straightforward. It doesn't give instructions. But it assumes that thinking about Jesus will be instructive. So it requires three things. What would Jesus do? First, you must use your critical faculties. Second, you must try to be Christ-centered. And third, you must dare to come to a conclusion. What would Jesus do? It's a question that requires an answer. We're going to close this service with the song, I've Decided to Follow Jesus. Let's make this our prayer. Amen.
The cross before me, no turning back. turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now?
So we've had our reading, we've fellowship, we've had a few hymns and songs, and we've found that God has been with us wherever we are today. If today is your first time worshipping with us, it is our hope and prayer that you find Holy Trinity in Tulse a place to worship with us, either on online or when we get back to our church building. We would love to see you join us so we can worship together as a community. Richard has brought God's word alive to each one of us, and we've learned from our Hebrew reading and the sermon how clearly the scripture is instructive. Also, how we have studied through that scripture, actually the theology that the author wanted to bring out to us. And also, quite importantly, we found out how that works in our lives and how we are able to process that. And give it take as well, how we allow God's Spirit to speak to our hearts so we can walk in the right direction. But before we come to a conclusion, let us take a moment to reflect on today's worship. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that you've been throughout all that we have done today. We worship you and we praise you. And as we look for this week's events, we pray that you uplift us through the obstacles and challenges, that you'd always be with us and reveal yourself as Christ, the root of all love. Amen. And now, may the blessing of God Almighty, who is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you for being with us, and we do hope to see you again next week in our online service.